Amen. 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 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 3. For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God, to the pulling down of strongholds, casting down imaginations, and every high thing that exalted itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Lift up your hands. Say, strongholds, strongholds of darkness. Catch fire now in the name of Jesus Christ. Bah, 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 bah. Every stronghold in my life, stronghold of darkness in this ministry, in this church, in our homes, receive the fire. Catch fire. Makoropo kose. Recochete de baba, de baba, de baba. Every stronghold. Catch fire, catch fire, catch fire. Stronghold of unrighteousness, catch fire. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Hallelujah. It says, having in readiness to revenge all disobedience when your obedience is fulfilled. It says, casting down imaginations, verse 5, and every high thing that exalted itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. Hallelujah. Say, every imagination and every high thing that is exalting itself against Jesus Christ in my life, in this church, in this ministry, in this nation, in our families, hear the word of God. We cast you down. We bring all your thoughts into captivity. To obedience of Christ in the name of Jesus. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Having in a readiness to revenge all disobedience when your obedience is fulfilled. Say, oh Lord, open my understanding. Let my own obedience be fulfilled. In the name of Jesus, help me, oh Lord, to submit to you. You better pray. In Jesus' name we pray. Father, we thank you. We thank you for your presence. Thank you because Satan is rebuked. His agents are rebuked. I want to thank you because the blood of Jesus is flowing in this place. The blood of the new and everlasting covenant. Lord, thank you for the fire of your presence. Thank you, omnipotent God. In Jesus' mighty name, we have worshipped. Amen. Amen. Let's be seated for a second. Hallelujah. God is good. Now, I have another brief teaching for you on fasting. And then we will go into prayer. Amen. Praise the Lord. Move forward. Forward, forward. Everybody to this side. Hallelujah. Jesus Christ expects every believer to fast. Amen. And to pray. Move forward. Hallelujah. As much as you can. Matthew chapter 6 from verse 16 to 18. Matthew 6 from verse 16 to 18. Moreover, when ye fast, be not as the hypocrites of a sad countenance, for they disfigure their faces, that they may appear unto men to fast. Verily I say unto you, they have their reward. But thou, when thou fastest, anoint thy head and wash thy face, that thou appear not unto men to fast, but unto thy Father which is in secret, and the Father which seeth in secret shall reward thee openly. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So the first thing that we want to establish here is that Jesus expects us to fast. Hallelujah. Every Christian, everyone in Christ is expected to fast according to that teaching. Amen. Amen. And it's supposed to be a fast unto the Lord. Hallelujah. Like we said yesterday, it's not a show. Amen. Amen. You don't put up a show. Because once you begin to announce to everybody, I'm weak because I'm fasting, or you are showing it and everybody can see it, you already got your reward. People will see you as a super person. Hallelujah. A person who is always fasting. So that's your reward. Amen. So God is not interested in that. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Our attitude as believers is not something that we want to do to impress anybody. Christianity is not about impressing you. I don't have to impress you. Hallelujah. And you don't have to impress me because I am not your rewarder. And you are not my rewarder. Clap for the Lord. Amen. Amen. So if I'm doing anything or you are doing anything to be seen as doing it, is known as eye service. Hallelujah. And God doesn't want that. Praise the Lord. Amen. He says if you do that and people praise you, you already got your reward. So you're wasting your time. Hallelujah. He says, but thou, when thou fastest, anoint thy head, wash thy face, that thou appear not unto men to fast, but unto thy Father which is in secret, and thy Father which seeth in secret shall reward thee openly. Hallelujah. Now, talking about reward, let's go back to Isaiah 58. Isaiah chapter number 58. How many of us want God the Father to reward us? He's a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. Isaiah 58. I hope somebody is taking care of those children there. Hallelujah. If your children are there, let them sit with you, please. Isaiah 58. We went through these scriptures elaborately yesterday. But I want to go to the part that talks about the reward. Verse 6. You see, Jesus says, your Father that sees you in secret will reward you openly. And so we want to look at the reward part and the condition for reward when you are fasting. It's not this the fast that I've chosen to loose the bands of wickedness, to undo the heavy burdens, and to let the oppressed go free, and that ye break every yoke? Is it not to deal thy bread to the hungry, and that thou bring the poor that are cast out to thy house, when thou seest the naked, and thou cover him, and that thou hide not thyself from thy own flesh? Then shall thy light break forth as the morning, and thy help shall spring forth speedily, and thy righteousness shall go before thee, the glory of the Lord shall be thy reward. Then shalt thou call, and the Lord shall answer, shall cry, and he shall say, here I am. If thou take away from the midst of thee the yoke, the putting forth of the finger, and speaking vanity. If thou draw out thy soul to the hungry, and satisfy the afflicted soul, then shall thy light rise in obscurity, and thy darkness be as a noonday. Hallelujah. Let me stop there a little bit. One thing that God needs to correct before the rapture is the attitude of the modern Christian. The modern Christian does not want to do anything. Hallelujah. Are you hearing me? God says, that the Lord says here, when you fast, and you fast in earnest, you fast unto God the Father, he will reward you openly. And here he begins to tell us about how to fast to be rewarded. When you are fasting, don't make it about yourself only. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. If you make your fasting and praying about yourself, you may get nothing. And that is why a lot of people fast and fast and fast year after year for the same problem that don't lift. Because they have not understood how to fast. Hallelujah. I will say this almost every night that I'm on this altar. It's not about you only. Are you hearing me? The word of God says so. The Lord says the fast that I choose is for you to lose the bands of wickedness. It's for you to undo the heavy burdens and to let your press go free and break every yoke. Hallelujah. So when you are fasting, have that in mind, that the will of God is for so many people to be set free through your prayer. Are you hearing me? Are you hearing me? For so many yokes to be broken as you seek the Lord. For so many other souls to be saved. Amen? You have to graduate from making Christianity about yourself. If that is what I did, you would not be sitting here. Clap for the Lord, hallelujah. Because if I talk about Christ, you may not be able to relate to that. If Christianity is just about me, you won't be sitting here. Maybe somebody else will have to do the work to get you saved. Are you hearing me? Praise the Lord. Because when I gave my life to the Lord, I also had a lot of issues, a lot of problems. A lot of things I wanted the Lord to solve for. But when he called me, he didn't call me and say, I want to solve your problem. He called me, clearly telling me, preach the gospel. Are you hearing me? He knew I had issues, serious ones. He said, preach the gospel. Set the captives free. Hallelujah. Then he said, whatever you do, pray. That's why a lot of people think Christ Love Ministries is just a prayer ministry. No, we are not just a prayer ministry. We are a teaching ministry. But the Lord told me, whatever you do, pray. Hallelujah. So it's all about seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and every other thing will be added to you. Please pay attention. Just look here. Other people you are looking at, they are human beings. They are not... I hope they are angels. Hallelujah. So just fix your eyes on me and hear something tonight. Hallelujah. I'm not saying God is not going to answer your personal prayers. Hear me well. Amen. I'm saying is that once you put yourself forward, you are going to really spend a lot of time persuading God to bless you. Clap for the Lord. Because he knows what you need. You see, the scripture we first read, 2 Corinthians chapter 10, let's go back there, from verse 4 to 6. Say, for the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. I hope we understand that. Hallelujah. Casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalted itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ, including your own. Hallelujah. Including your own thoughts that are all over the place, that are going haywire. Bring them unto the obedience of Christ. Hallelujah. Then verse 6 says, and having in a readiness to revenge all disobedience when your obedience is fulfilled. You don't even have to ask God to fight for you. You just obey him. Are you hearing me? You don't have to worry about your husband, about your wife, about your children, about what you will eat or what you will drink. You just obey him. And see whether he will not reward you. Are you hearing me? Praise the Lord. In fact, when you go to that Matthew 6 that we just read, it's what Jesus began to say. Let's go there. Matthew 6, if we need to come back to Isaiah 58. Isaiah 58, God tells you, when you fast, before I leave that place, because I may not come back there. Isaiah 58, verse 6 to 7. It says, when you fast, this is what I want. Are you hearing me? Somebody say, thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. When you fast, it says, this is what I want. Hallelujah. It's not saying, what do you want? Usually God asks us, what do you want when you praise him very highly? But when you are seeking him, he would like to tell you what he wants. Are you hearing me? I hope you are praying. When you are praying, you will see. Hallelujah. That God talks and he says, this is what I want. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Amen. Okay. So he says, when you fast, set the captives free. Pray for the prisoners, spiritual prisoners, physical prisoners, those who are sick, those who are in bondage, even those witches that are flying around that need deliverance, pray for somebody to be set free. Clap for the Lord. Hallelujah. Clap very well. And then he says, when you are fasting, amen, share your food. Learn to share. Hallelujah. You see, the reason why the gospel is slow, moving slowly, is because we are selfish. Hallelujah. We don't talk about Jesus the way we should. We don't care about our neighbors, our colleagues, who we know need Jesus. Hallelujah. Amen. We just use Jesus Christ as panacea. Know what panacea is? Panadol. For him to keep relieving your pain. He didn't die for you alone. He died for the world. The Bible says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. So what are you going to give back? And fasting and seeking the Lord is your opportunity to give something back to the kingdom. To stay in your room and pray for somebody. Pray against COVID-19. Pray that 2022 will really be a better year for every one of us. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. God is looking for intercessors. People who will rescue this world. Let me tell you, there is nothing God can do if you don't pray. Are you hearing me? Because the church is the arm of God on earth. We are his mouthpiece. We are his feet. We are his hands. So if the church is useless, the world will die. That's why he says, if my people that are called by my name will humble themselves and seek my face and pray and repent from their sins, he says, I will forgive their sin and heal the land. Hallelujah. So the church is irresponsible. Many Christians, when it comes to what God wants, are totally oblivious. They don't even know his will. And if they do, they are too lazy to do it. So God wants things to change this year. Clap for the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So every time you see me standing here, I will talk Isaiah 58 to you. It says, if you will just pray for others, if you will set the captives free, if you will share your food and share your clothes, share your money, if you are not going to be selfish, when you call me, I will answer you. That's what it says in the next verse. Hallelujah. Verse 8. Then shall thy light break forth as the morning, and thy health shall spring forth speedily. You'll be healed. Instead of saying, oh Lord, I don't want to die from cancer. I don't want to die from HIV/AIDS. You pray for those who have HIV/AIDS. Oh Lord, this year must not pass me. This barrenness must break. Pray for others who are barren. Hallelujah. Who don't even have Christ. Pray for sinners. That's what he's saying. Hallelujah. Amen. Have you understood that? I hope so. And then he says, then I will heal you. Do I hear amen?
Amen.
Say, then I will heal you. Hallelujah. Then I will answer you. Then I will reward you. If you also stop speaking lies, vanity. Amen. If you change your character, then I will bless you. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Somebody may say, then why are we talking so much about works? Ephesians chapter 2. That's why I say today's Christianity is an irresponsible Christianity. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. That's why the Lord says many are called, but few are chosen. Many come to Christ, but few obey him. You need to change that for yourself. Hallelujah. Amen. We're not saying this so you feel guilty. We're saying so you change and be blessed so that you will not waste 21 days getting hungry. God says, don't waste your time. You need to obey my instructions. Hallelujah. Ephesians 2. Verse 8. For by grace are ye saved through faith, that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God had before ordained that we should walk in them. Please give me NLT. Give me those scriptures in NLT. Hallelujah. Let's read it together. For we are God's masterpiece. Everybody say masterpiece.
Masterpiece.
Do you know the meaning of masterpiece?
Yes.
Huh? Who knows the meaning of masterpiece? You don't know masterpiece?
Classic.
That's too high for them still. What is masterpiece?
Perfect
work. Thank you. Exemplary work. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Somebody say, I'm God's perfect work. Say it again. You know, when you write, I remember when I wrote my PhD degree, my supervisor said, your introduction is a masterpiece.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Masterpiece means it's perfect. It cannot be faulted. So that is who God has made you to be. King James calls you workmanship. It says, he has created us anew in Christ Jesus so we can do good things. Do you see that? So we can do what? So we can do what? So we can preach the gospel. So we can help others. So we can be useful to his kingdom. Hallelujah. Which he has planned for us long ago. Amen. Amen. Verse 10. They put everything together. So that's just it. So that we can look at verse 11 and say, don't forget that you Gentiles used to be outsiders. You were called uncircumcised heathens, useless, by the Jews who were proud of their circumcision. Let's leave that alone. Hallelujah. Just know that God created you a masterpiece. When you gave your life to Jesus, He made you perfect. He perfected that which concerns you. So you can be useful to him. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. Praise the Lord. So God is saying, I'm tired of religious fast. I've told you yesterday that other religions also fast. Even Satanists, they fast. Amen? Amen. So it's not anything new. He's just saying, when you fast, make a difference. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Look at Titus. Titus chapter 2, verse 11. You give it to me in both, yes. Let's first read it in King James. It says, for the grace of God that bringeth salvation had appeared to all men, teaching us that denying ungodliness, can you please tell him that there's serious echo here? Teaching us to deny ungodliness and worldly lusts, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world, looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearance of the great God and our Savior, Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us, that he might redeem us from all iniquity and purify unto himself a peculiar people, zealous of good works. These things speak and exhort and rebuke with all authority. Let no man despise thee. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. I want us to read it in NLT. For the grace of God has been revealed, bringing salvation to all people. Are you saved? Are you born again? All right. Many of us, we just stop at born again. The next thing after you are born again is this. We are instructed to turn from godless living and sinful pleasures after you give your life to Jesus. We should live in this evil world with wisdom, righteousness, and devotion to God, while we look forward with hope to that wonderful day when the glory of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ, will be revealed. He gave his life to free us from every kind of sin, to cleanse us and to make us his own people, totally committed to doing what? To doing what? Totally committed. You must teach these things and encourage the believers to do them. You have the authority to correct them when necessary, so don't let anyone disregard what you say. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. You are meant to do good works. Praise the Lord. Clap for the Lord. Hallelujah. So, don't belittle what you are hearing. What you have been hearing since yesterday. Don't. If you are not going to do it, don't even bother to fast. Because I'm telling you the mind of God for the now. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Now, we are not all called to be full-time pastors. Hallelujah. Not every one of us can pay the same price to be full-time. It's come at a cost. And not every one of us can do that. But one thing we can all do is kneel down in our bedroom and pray for those who are not saved. Clap for the Lord. Hallelujah. We can all do it. Hallelujah. And we can all open our mouths at work, at school, in our family, and talk about Jesus. So, It's actually your own interest. Hallelujah. Turn to your neighbor and say, in your own interest, change. Do these things. Take time to pray for others. Take time to preach the gospel. You don't have to do it full time. Hallelujah. And you don't even have to convert anybody. You are not a converter. Jesus is the one that converts. The Holy Spirit is the one that convicts and converts people. Your own is to preach the gospel. Tell somebody about Jesus. Hallelujah. Christianity is beyond just coming to church, minding my business, and going out. Coming to church, you can say, yes, but in the church, I stand at the camera, that's good. I'm in the choir, that's good. I'm an usher, that's good. I'm an elder, I give my, that's good. Hallelujah. That is in the church. There are people out there that need to be in the church. That need to be born again. Hallelujah. They need your prayer. Amen. Amen. They need your prayer. They need your message. They need your kindness. That's one of the reasons why the Lord is telling us, share what you have. Because sometimes we preach the gospel with what we do, not just with what we say. Hallelujah. Amen. 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 Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Amen. There is power in sharing. I just remember a story that happened to me when I was a student in France. I was not born again. I didn't know the Lord. But I was a student. And we went, our class went to a remote area for an exam or for something. And there was no food there. We couldn't find anything to buy to eat. I have the habit till today of always throwing an apple in my bag. An apple, a banana, two apples, sweets. So I always have something. Even as I was coming back from the U.S., there were things that happened that, you know, if I didn't have something in my bag, I would have been hungry. And those around me, I shared with them. So I have that habit. And so there was a small cafe. And maybe within 10 minutes, because we were many, all the food in the cafe was sold out. So the rest of us on the line, still waiting to be served, had no food. So we just sat there at the table, and there was this English girl, a white girl. I'll never forget her name. She sat there at the table, and now I brought out my apple. We were both hungry. So I looked at her, and I said, okay, I'm hungry. You're hungry, let's share. So no. It's too, I said, look, in Africa we share. She said, no, you don't have to do that. I said, don't speak English to me. Let's share. So I cut the apple into two, and we both ate. This girl never forgot it. For half an apple, listen to me, when it was June, and I needed to go home, I wanted to go home, but I didn't have enough money. She was going back to England, and she told me, come back with me, you can get a job and buy your ticket for half an apple. I didn't know her from Adam's. Are you hearing me? There's power in sharing. I stayed with her parents for the 2 months. They made sure I got a job. They fed me every day. And I had enough money to buy my ticket and go to Nigeria for half an apple. Hallelujah. Amen. She couldn't believe it. Amen. That's what God is saying. That's what he's talking about. Get rid of selfishness. I was not a Christian, no. I just knew that we're both hungry. How do I start to eat this apple when this girl is looking at me? So we both ate the apple and we drank water. And we went our ways. But then she took my phone number, the phone number of my hostel. She kept in touch. She kept coming. She was impressed. Praise the Lord. May God help you impress somebody. You don't even know who you are giving half an apple to. Abraham did not know who he was entertaining. When those three angels stood, and he quickly called his wife to go and knead the dough and bake some cake. The Bible says he called a young man. They took a calf and dressed it. He put butter and milk before the angels. They ate. You don't know who you are giving half an apple to. It could be an angel. The Bible says some have entertained angels without knowing it. Hallelujah. And when the angels finished eating, they now started to prophesy. He now said, by this time next year, Sarah will give birth. Even Sarah that cooked for them was laughing. Because she was 90 years old. Abraham was 100 years old. They have forgotten about that promise. When are you going to release your miracle by doing good? Not just by fasting, but by helping. Because God will always bring somebody around you. It could be your own child. It could be your mother. It could be your brother. It could be a total stranger. The problem is that we never know when we should do good. Hallelujah. God will bring somebody around you that needs your help. That needs just $1. A slice of bread. Church, you can fast till kingdom come. If it is time to sow a seed, you must sow a seed. And that's why we put this box here. Based on Isaiah 58, that 21 days, we put something in this box. Some of you will not come back tomorrow now and say, you say 21 days, I must give an offering. Why are you worshiping money so much? Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Do something. You never know when your miracle will be released. Clap for the Lord. Hallelujah. Because when we teach this theory here, you may not understand. I'll tell you another one. This is about financing Christ's love. When I realized that God was talking to me about mission, about this, about that, I didn't know what to do. And the church was still young. We could hardly pay the people that were working there. And the Lord was talking about missions and this. He was talking about these ministries here. I didn't know where Namibia was. He didn't even mention Namibia at first. He was just telling me, I'm taking you out of the country. So when I realized that, and I was like, I was looking at plane ticket, money, I know ministry costs money. So I started to wait on the Lord. How are you going to finance it? Hallelujah. I was praying for financial breakthrough for these ministries. Look, that's why we never lack. Because I did the homework already. Clap for the Lord. Hallelujah. I fasted and prayed. While I was fasting and praying, a servant of God came to me from another town, maybe some 200 kilometers away, and came to me and said, the Lord said I should give him 10,000 naira. I laughed. Because I was very broke. I was praying for the ministry. But God helped me. I had read I've read the book of Ida Hossa, and I've read about seed sowing. So immediately he said that, I knew that God wanted to answer my prayers. Hallelujah. I knew immediately he said, God said. I was waiting on the Lord for money. Everyone say for money. Not for myself, but for Christ Love Ministries. And here was a man of God standing there looking at me and said, God said, I should give 10. I didn't have 10,000 cents. So I look at him. I said, no problem. I said, in fact, when he came, I thought it was the answer to my prayer because he had a briefcase. But when I look at the briefcase, his briefcase looked poorer than my handbag. So I knew that he was not coming to help me. Hallelujah. He said, the Lord said, da 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 da. I said, okay. First he said, the Lord sent me to you. I was very happy, but I look at the briefcase. I said, my answer is. I said, sit down. Then he talked. And immediately God gave me grace to understand that that's the answer to the prayer. But I didn't have the money. So I told him, I said, here, look here. My husband was in Ethiopia. He had left two cars in the house. One was a B2, the other one was a 505 Peugeot. So I said, take the B2. You know what B2 is? The Volkswagen B2. How many of you have seen B2? You are too young to know B2. B2 goes. How many of you know B2? Those of us who are old, you know B2. Yes. The one behind you, Pastor. How old are you? No, not you, my. You are what? Maybe you know B2. It's possible. It's a German Volkswagen. Very funny. Anyway, we very strong car. Very, very strong. So it was there. And my husband had told me, never use the two cars at once because when they break down, you won't be able to fix them. So I was very careful not to go to B2 because when B2 breaks, so I gave him the key of the B2. I didn't like the B2, so I gave him. I said, go sell this B2. Sell it. Take the 10,000 and give me the change because that will be the answer to my prayer. Hallelujah. Clap for the Lord. He took the key hesitantly, but he took it. When he left, he was actually going to minister in our church. The following day was a Sunday. When he left, in the night, the Holy Spirit woke me up and said, that B2 that you gave away, is it yours? I said, Lord, it belongs to the family. All right. He said, what will you tell your husband? I said, I will say you took it. It's good to hear the Lord. I said, Lord, you took it. So he didn't say any other thing. He said, okay. He said to me that night, the man will give you back the key tomorrow morning, and I'll put the money in your hands, and you must give him. I said, thank you. In fact, I was relieved because I was already waiting for proof. I don't know. I knew I would get it. So I was relieved. The following day, I got to church. I was very, in fact, I was praying for the day to break. I saw this pastor. The first thing he did was to come to me before he went to preach on our pulpit and give me back the key. I said, God bless you, Pastor. God bless you. I was so relieved. And then I told him what the Lord said. He said, don't worry. The Lord said I should give you back the key. So I took the key. In that week, Daddy sent us money. When we changed the dollars he sent, what we had left after changing the dollars was exactly 10,000 naira. The money that man of God asked for. And the Lord said, I will put it in your hand. Look, I'm teaching you how to walk with God. Because that money was in my hand. The man of God did not know it was there. I could have eaten it. Is that not so? I said, God will forgive me. And then I would have been struggling financially to run the ministry.
In any event, immediately I saw that extra 10,000. I called the brother that used to drive me around. I said, "My brother, how many ears do you have?" He says, "Two." I say, "Pull your ears off. As I put this money in your hand, take that 504. Drive to Ife. Now, before I change my mind." I said, "Just drive and take it to that pastor." Clap for the Lord. Hallelujah. How much is 10,000 naira? We have spent millions, millions upon millions in Christ's love ministries after that. Clap for the Lord. Hallelujah. I'm teaching you a secret to your breakthrough. Amen. Don't be smarter than God. When you seek Him, you are seeking Him so that He can talk to you. Sometimes when we are seeking the Lord and we are fasting, we are praying, we think that, oh, maybe $3 million will be, somebody will come and give it to you just like that. So you can run, we have even spent much more than that since that time. But God will only answer you with a word. Hallelujah. He will speak. That's why He says, revenging every disobedience when your obedience is fulfilled. "Oh Lord, heal me, heal me, heal me." He will say, "Okay. Why don't you pray for your neighbor there, down there? You don't even know whether the neighbor is sick or not." But if you don't have ears to hear, you keep praying your prayer points. He has already answered you. He has told you, "This is what I want to do." Hallelujah. Are we following tonight? So that is the essence of fasting. To seek the face of the Lord so we can know His will and do His will and get our breakthrough. Clap for the Lord. Hallelujah. Now, why is it that we don't understand fasting, or we don't even want to fast, or we don't want to pray? It's just the devil. The devil knows the power that is in fasting. He knows the power that when you fast, your entire system submits to your spirit. Your mind submits to your spirit, your body submits to your spirit, so he doesn't want you to fast. And he knows that when you fast and you pray, you can hear your Father. Hallelujah. And then your life can change. Amen. So that's why once fast is announced, many begin to develop all kinds of psychological reactions to food inside, to put food inside. They go from sorrow to fear to greed. They're just afraid. But I've never known anybody killed by fasting. Do you know one? Fasting. In fact, when we are talking about fasting and you are sorrowful, you are unhappy, do you always eat? No, come on now. You don't always eat. Huh? There are some days that you forget to eat till 6 o'clock because you are busy. Or you forget to eat till 4. Am I talking to somebody? Because you're so busy. Maybe it's exam time, and you teachers are running around. You brought lunch, you didn't eat it. There are days like that. So what is it that once you hear fasting, you run away from church until the fast is over? The devil is a liar. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. It's okay. I mean, nobody hates food. We all like our food. Is that not so? But we know that God says we should fast, and it is for our own benefit, so that we can hear Him, so He can guide us, so He can instruct us. Hallelujah. Amen. So take a decision to fast. Even if you cannot do all the 21 days, I want to encourage you not to do all the 21 days, because that's an injunction. It's a command. Take a decision that you will do it. Amen. Maybe as we go on, we'll look at other benefits, health, there are serious health benefits in fasting. Amen. So instead of getting afraid or being sorrowful or missing food, ask God for grace. Everybody say grace. Grace. There is nothing we can do without Him. Hallelujah. Don't take it for granted that, oh, is it not fasting? I can just jump into it. No. like we did yesterday, pray about it. God, I'm giving you my stomach. Hallelujah. By the way, you will notice that I've noticed, and I think that happened today, that in these 21 days, you rarely feel hungry. Is that not so? Once we pray about it, you just see that you're not really hungry. Amen. Amen. You just want to drink, maybe drink, if you like, something with sugar. If you want to drink juice, that's okay. Or you want to take a cup of tea, sugar in it. But you don't really feel hungry. Clap for the Lord for his grace. Amen. So the first thing is to have a desire, because it's a secret place where you hear God. Where God gives you, I've just given you a serious example, where God gives you breakthroughs that are just not in this world. They are out of this world. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. And when you begin to see those breakthroughs come to pass, as you learn to fast and pray, you will commit yourself to it. Even after the 21 days, you commit yourself to seeking the Lord. You make it, there is something known as a fasted life. That is, your diet will change, and you will let it change. You eat what is needed only. Hallelujah. What is necessary. But I'm not leading you into that. That's probably for some of us who are full-time ministers. There's something known as fasted life. Amen. However, you must deliberately choose to deal with your stomach. Amen. With your flesh. Everybody say flesh. Because there's nothing good in the flesh. The flesh doesn't want you to do the will of God. Amen. The Bible tells us that the flesh, look at Galatians 5. Galatians 5 verse 16 says, "This I say then, walk in the Spirit, and ye shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh," that is the desires of the flesh. "For the flesh lusteth against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh, and these are contrary the one to the other, so that ye cannot do the things that ye would." Amen. So there's always a fight between the flesh and the Spirit. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You see, if you are not like mature in the art of fasting and seeking the Lord, you will notice that the day you say, "I'm going to fast," and you haven't prayed about it, that is the day you wake up looking for English breakfast. Am I talking to somebody? You wake up hungry. You'll be like, in fact, if care is not taken, you would have finished eating before you remember that, I told the Lord I will fast today. Why? Because the flesh wanted to kill that desire. And who is behind the flesh? Satan. Hallelujah. If Satan came to your room with his horns, like, you know, they draw him in the school books and say, "Oh, I will show you Brenda today. You think you can fast?" You will say, "I banned you. This and that." Then you know it's the devil. You will now say, but it won't come through. It won't come like that. He will tell you are weak, you are tired, you are hungry. And then you go and eat. You know what? You have a headache. Yeah. How many of you have a headache? How many of you really? No. I want to tell you something about that. When you experience headache, how many of you experience headache when you are fasting? When you experience headache when fasting, number one, it's a sign that you are not used to fasting. Hallelujah. It's a sign that exercise, you have neglected it for a long time. Number two, it's also a sign that toxins are being burnt. Amen? We're going to discuss that. We will get there. You will get headache. Of course, you get headache, you'll be hungry. David says, "My knees are weak through fasting." You'll be weak. Hallelujah. It's true. When you want to climb the stairs, you'll be climbing like an old woman. It's normal because there is no fuel in the system to carry you. So don't be afraid of those things. Don't let the devil come. Don't let him come and talk to you like he talked to Eve. Are you really? Don't let him come to you and say, you know what? You are going to be weak. You are going to have a headache. You are going to die. It's a lie. Hallelujah. You will not die. Somebody say, I shall not die. Amen. Because he wants to rob you. He knows that fasting will bring you closer to God. God will be talking to you. You will be talking to God. You get your breakthroughs. You will break his head. So he comes to bruise your heel. Hallelujah. You know, there's a saying that by most women, that the way to a man's heart is through his stomach. Is that not so? So Satan also knows that secret. He knows that the way to your heart is through your belly. So that's why you must pray. Don't just assume. Every day, commit your stomach to the Holy Spirit. Clap for the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Why did Adam and Eve fall and put mankind in trouble forever? The serpent convinced Eve to eat from the forbidden tree. She then saw that the tree was good for food. She also gave her husband, and he ate. And so with just one meal, Adam and Eve sold us out. Hallelujah. They went from peacefully enjoying God's presence to fearfully hiding from his presence. Don't let one plate of mahangu keep you from the presence of God. Clap for the Lord. Hallelujah. They ate themselves out of the will of God and out of his plan for their lives. They ate themselves out of God's presence, provision and protection. They became naked and exposed just for the love of food. They died spiritually. Hallelujah. When the Lord said to them, if they ate from that tree of the knowledge of good and evil, that they would die. They didn't fall down dead. Immediately they were tempted by the devil and they ate it. It means that they would die spiritually. It means they will not have the presence of God. It means that they will not enjoy that fellowship with God. When the next time they heard the voice of God, it was rebuke and curses. Hallelujah. Amen. They lost their home, their paradise, to eating. You see, there are a lot of things that God is probably going to give you, like I just shared with you. Financial breakthroughs. Don't just sit down there and be eating food. Hallelujah. Amen. Because you just get a temporary satisfaction, but then you will suffer the consequences. Homosexuality was not the only sin of Sodom and Gomorrah. Ezekiel 16, look at it quickly. Ezekiel 16 from verse 49 to 50. Ezekiel chapter 16, NLT also. Behold, this was the iniquity of thy sister Sodom, pride, fullness of bread, and abundance of idleness was in her and in her daughters. Neither did she strengthen the hand of the poor and needy. Do you see that? Hello? Hello? Okay, let's read it in NLT. Sodom's sins were pride, gluttony, and laziness, while the poor and needy suffered outside her door. Do you see that? That's what God has been trying to tell us to correct. Pride. That is when God, let me tell you who a proud person is. So. Let me quickly correct that. You think a person who is quiet and is humble? No. A proud person is a person that doesn't obey God. Hallelujah. No matter what he says, you do your own thing. And you may be very quiet and people may like you. People are very poor judges of character. They just look at me and say, oh, that woman, she's just an angel. Who told you so? She doesn't talk. Ah. But this is a person that has nothing to do with God. When God talks, he or she will go and do their own thing. Okay, that's the person that God calls proud. Gluttony, that just loves food. Laziness. How many of you know that prayer takes work? Huh? Come on now, how many of you know prayers is work? That's why many people don't like to pray. Hallelujah. Come Sunday now, this place will be full. When it is time to pray, few of us. Hallelujah. Amen. Laziness, pride, loving to eat too much, and neglecting the poor. Those are the problems of Sodom and Gomorrah, not just homosexuality. Hallelujah. So, they were guilty of prayerlessness, pride, idleness, not giving to the poor and needy. They were also guilty of the love of food. The same thing with Esau. He lost his inheritance to food. And when he realized that he has lost his inheritance, it was too late for him to retrieve it. You will not lose your inheritance this time in the name of Jesus. Amen. Hallelujah. Satan tried the same trick with the Lord. As I say, he tried it with Jesus. I'm sure he tempted you today to eat. Say, eat, you are not the bishop. She will pray for you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Eat now. Eat. He's trying to rob you. Of course, I will pray for you. But I am, when the trumpet sounds, you're not going to hold on to my skirt. Hallelujah. You have to have that relationship with God. And this is one of the reasons why he's calling us to fast. So he can talk to us about us. Hallelujah. He can tell us where we are missing it. He can tell us what we are doing wrong. He can tell us what we need to correct. He can even tell us how to get a good job. Clap for the Lord. He will tell you secrets. How to make more money. He will show you. Amen. So Satan tried that trick with the Lord. But the word of God is the sword of the spirit that Jesus used to defeat him. Matthew chapter 4 from verse 1 to 4. Then was Jesus led up of the spirit into the wilderness to be tempted of the devil. To be tempted. So just know something. When you are fasting, the enemy will tempt you. And when he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights, he was afterward hungry. And when the tempter came to him, he said, if thou be the Son of God, command that these stones be made bread. But he answered and said, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. Hallelujah. You know the rest of the story. He will even come to you and say, why are you going to suffer for 21 days? Huh? Are you not under grace? Hallelujah. Why are you listening to Elizabeth? What do you even know she is doing in her house? He will come and tell you. He will tempt you and deceive you. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Now the Lord will teach us how to use the word of the Spirit, the sword of the Spirit, in warfare as we pray these days. Hallelujah. It is time, you know, most of the times as we'll be praying in this program, we'll be using the word of God. Hallelujah. To pray. You will use the word against the spiritual enemies of your soul. And you will see great victories as you use God's word correctly. And most of the prayers that we are going to be using, I took from the prayers that routed demons by John Eckhart. He said, he discovered the secret of praying the word of God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So, we are ready. Are we ready to pray? I want us to stand up on our feet. Hallelujah. Amen. Choir, we are going to sing Another Year is Dawning. I hope you are ready to sing it. Pastor Collins, you are welcome back. May God bless you. Let's clap for the Lord for joining us. Amen.
done it. Their Father, let it be. In walking or in waiting, another year within, another year of progress, another year of praise, another year of proving thy presence on the earth, another year of mercies, of faithfulness and grace, another year of gladness, is shining on thy face,
another year of living,
another year of living.
Make it a prayer. One, two, go.
Another year is born. Yeah, Father, let it be there. Father, let it be. In one.